It's been 13 days since we found out about the aliens and everything, and both based on the number, 13, even though I'm not superstitious, and the fact that I went on a crazy adventure yesterday. I mean, it was good. I'm glad I got the aloe. Time well spent, but that was still pretty crazy. I'm planning on just staying at home today, and I've got a good reason to, because literally the morning before, you know, all the aliens were on the news and everything like that, we all found out about it. Literally that morning I was at the grocery store and I bought a lot of produce, in particular tomatoes. It was a great discount rate on tomatoes. I got a whole box of tomatoes, and both myself and Monica have been going through those, trying to eat those first because, you know, they're going to go bad first. But there's still a lot left, and they've gotten to the point where they, you know, they're going bad. So what I decided to do this morning is to cook them up, and I'm going to preserve them and put them into cans. Now, I've had them going on the stove for a little while here. I put in tomatoes. I put in some onions. What else did I put in there? I put some pumpkin in there. I mixed in some pumpkin that I had previously canned. Mixed that in. Some salt and seasonings and stuff like that. I'm making kind of like a salsa sort of thing. I put some hot peppers in there that I had dried. So I've had that going this morning, and that's going to preserve the nutrition from all those tomatoes so that I can have them later, and Monica and I don't have to gorge ourselves over the next 3 days on nothing but tomatoes, because that would be dreadful. They've been cooking on here for a while. I've got them down to a level where I think they're ready to be canned. And the cans that I'm going to be using for them are these little jars here. Now, these are just the kind of jars that you would get at a grocery store. These just to actually have salsa in them. They're Newman salsa jars. And I have in the past had a lot of luck just using these as a method for canning. Now, they're a special mason jars. You know, Ball makes them. There's some other brands. Ball is like the big one that I always see around here. And those are great, and they have advantages over these, but one of the advantages that these have is that they come free with everything that you buy in a jar in a store. So I've been saving these over time, and like I said, I've been using them, and I've probably canned maybe several hundred of these things, you know, reused them, and I think maybe one or two didn't manage to get a seal. So that's a pretty good track record. I mean, it's like 98-99% success rate, and many of them I've reused a couple times. Now, the precaution I need to take is when I'm putting stuff into these, they can crack a lot more easily. So the stuff I have on the stove here that's been cooking, that's hot, and I've been having these right next to the wood stove, so it's emanating a lot of heat out at them. If you ever use these things, you want to make sure that they are not getting shocked with the temperature. So you either want to be putting something in that's not super hot, or you want to be preheating these. And this one is pretty hot to begin with. Like I said, there's a lot of heat coming out here, and I've got them arranged right in front. So they're kind of getting preheated, and that'll prevent them from cracking when the hot liquid touches cold glass, which they would if I tried to put it in cold. But other than that, I've had a really good success rate with them, and they're free. I've got hundreds of them, and they're gonna save me today. So the way that you do it is you take the lid off, obviously, and you know, there's all sorts of things about like cleaning them off and everything. I wash these and I leave them pretty clean, and when I store them, I should mention, I don't put the lids on very tightly. I just kind of lightly put the lids on, and that's because there's a kind of a foamy gasket around here, and you want that foamy gasket to get a good impression when you put it back on these guys. So what I make sure I don't do is that I don't leave them all like tightened down, so because that would crush down the gasket. You want the gasket to kind of refresh itself, puff back up a little bit, so then when you put it on, you know, for a real seal, it's actually going to seal. So none of these have their lids particularly tightly put on. I just kind of lightly put them on and leave them like that. So got the lid here, and the tools I need are this funnel. And that helps to keep you from dripping any you know, goop on the side of this thing. Do that. Actually, I'll put this right here. And I've got a ladle. So let's see, how do we do this? Grab this here. And I'm just gonna take this stuff and just very carefully drop it right in. And the amount of space you want left at the top as you're filling these up, you don't want to you don't want to fill them up all the way. For something like this, I would leave like a nice half inch, maybe a little more than a half inch, but no more than that. And the reason you want to leave some space is because what creates the seal on these later on is the vacuum that gets created at the top when you heat up everything that's in these jars, and then everything contracts later on, everything will, what I usually do is I open up the next one and use the next one to hold the funnel so I don't make a mess. So taking the lid, you put the lid on, oh, it's pretty hot. And for these, I like to wrench the lids down pretty tightly because the difference between, the difference between these and say like the actual mason jars is that with the actual mason jars, you kind of have like this free floating ring that, you know, you can take off afterwards and it's just the pressure holding on. But with these, you really want to get the lid cranked down to where you're ultimately going to want it and just sort of leave it there. It still leaves space for the gas to escape so you can get a good seal later on. And I've had luck with that, you know, tightening them down all the way. So I'm going to take this. It's pretty hot, so I'm going to use this guy. This is what we're going to use to put it into the water bath. And I'm just going to set this to side over here, over by the wood stove, kind of keep it warm. And we're going to do a few more of these. And then what we're going to do is we're going to take them and we're going to put them into our hot water bath here. And we're going to cook them. I ended up being able to make 6 jars of salsa, which is pretty cool. I wouldn't normally, under most circumstances, stack them in this sort of dangerous pyramid, but I thought it was a nice display for the camera. That's awesome, because now those nutrients are locked into those jars, and I'm not gonna have to like rush through, you know, eating them, gorging myself on tomatoes and everything like that. So that's great, but there is one more step, obviously. We have to sterilize them and put them in a wash of hot water to kill everything and help to create the seal. So what I've had going on back here is a big pot of water, kind of on the side of the stove, because I didn't want to heat the water up too much. And the reason for that, again, is because these are not real mason jars, and you don't want to be shocking the glass by taking it being, you know, mildly warm and putting it into scalding hot water, because then it could crack. Now with mason jars, I could pull something like that, but even with mason jars, I try to baby them a little bit because I know that you get more life out of the glass. The literature that comes with real mason jars oftentimes says that the jars only have a certain life to them, and, you know, eventually, you know, they're going to wear out from the shock of the temperature changes. So I try to even baby mason jars when I'm using them, but certainly with these non-mason jars, you don't want to be taking something that's cool or even warm and putting it into something super, super hot. So I'm going to put it into the water before it gets too hot here. So I'll take the lid off here, and the water is just lightly warm, but not hot yet. It's kind of dangerous. This pyramid was not a good idea. Okay, so I'm going to take the first one. And, in the bottom here, I have a little spacer in here. And the reason for the spacer is you don't want to have the jar directly on the bottom surface of the pot. It's better to have it, you know, separated with a little bit of, you know, a little bit of a gap so the hot water can all circulate around it. You don't get hot spots with it directly touching the burner. So I've got a spacer right in the bottom here that's going to keep them from touching. So put in one. And I put in enough water in here. I measured it out. I kind of have a sense of how much I need to use. I put in enough water here so that when I put these jars in, the water level should go just a little over the top. And that's important when you're doing a hot water bath, you know, sealing these jars, is you want to make sure the water level is just a little bit over the top. You know, maybe a half an inch or so to account for some of it boiling off. All right, so I put the rest of these guys in here. The reason that it's okay for me to be putting this stuff into just a regular hot water bath, as opposed to pressure canning it, which gets a little more serious, is because the tomatoes that make up the main ingredient in salsa are very acidic. And things that are very acidic are far less prone to be getting botulism than things that are have a higher pH, that are more alkaline. Things like potatoes, beans, carrots. If you ever can any of those things, you need a pressure canner because the pH of those is not low enough, it's not acidic enough to keep botulism from growing in the jar. Things that are acidic, the acid environment just isn't hospitable to botulism, so you don't have to worry about it as much. But certainly with anything, like I said, beans, potatoes, carrots, things like that, anything like that that doesn't have an acid component to it, that's not very acidic, you need to put that in a pressure canner and do that a whole other way. But for high acid foods like tomatoes. You can just put them in boiling water and that is totally fine. So I've got these all in here. It looks like they've got a good top space of water covering them. And that's it. What I'm gonna do is just lid this up and let this warm up. Once it starts boiling, I'm gonna leave them in there for about 30 minutes or so, and that will do two things. One, it's going to obviously kill anything that's in there. That's the reason that you're doing the boil, is to kill any bacteria or whatever, just little spores that, come out of the air and everything. There's little organisms in there. We want to kill all those things. And that's what the heat's doing. The other thing that it's doing is that it is, if you recall, there's a little headspace of air at the top of each one of those jars. And that headspace of air has a certain number of atoms in it. It makes it a certain density. As we heat it up, that air is expanding. It's bubbling up out of those lids. And then later on, when we take that out, there are less atoms in there. So when it cools back down, that's going to be a much less dense section of air than the rest of the atmosphere around us. And that's going to create that vacuum seal as the rest of the atmosphere is pushing down on that vacuum. That's going to hold the lid down, hold the seal, and keep any other germs that we didn't kill, that are, flying around here, from going inside and infecting those things. So two things. You're killing everything, and you're making sure that you got a good seal on there. And that's what the heat's doing for you. So we got to let this get up to temperature, wait for it to boil. Wait a half an hour, and then we'll see what we got on the inside, if they all survived. While the salsa is all boiling out there, I figured I'd come in here and kind of take stock of what I have in the pantry. Just yesterday, Monica was going through our medical stuff, kind of figuring out what we have for medical, and now we have a concrete list of everything that we have access to. We have a sense of where our deficits are and what we have plenty of. So that felt kind of good, so I figured I'd do the same thing for the pantry. And just looking through it, I feel pretty good about it. I have a lot of stuff stored in these big, these are pet food containers. They're FDA approved for food, whatever that means. I used to always take what the FDA said with a grain of salt, but the plastic is number two plastic. A lot of food, comes from the store and number two plastic. So I felt reasonably safe keeping stuff in here, especially when it's dried stuff. This one's got cane sugar in it. It's really heavy with cane sugar, quinoa, chickpeas, black-eyed peas, pinto beans, a bunch of flours, rice down on the bottom, chia seeds, lots of different stuff. And it seems like I've got quite a bit here. I've got a lot of dried fruit, a lot of canned stuff. I feel pretty good about this part of our situation. And in particular, one thing that I always did a lot of experimentation with in the past is the idea of what sort of foods really last for a while. Like you can say, well, dried fruit is good because it's dry and it lasts longer. But in my experimentation, there are some dried fruits that last a lot longer than other dried fruits. For example, at one point there was a sale on apricots, dried apricots. I bought a lot of dried apricots and they had a major mold meltdown, and they smelled alcoholic after a while, and they were not good for eating anymore after that point. So that was a bad experience I had with apricots. But other things, and maybe that was just a one-time thing, maybe that was an aberration, but I stayed away from apricots after that, dried apricots, I mean. But other things like dried papaya, dried grapes, raisins, dried cranberries, I've got dried goji berries in here, dried mango. All those things, over the years, I found really last a long time. You don't really have to worry about those things going moldy and spoiling and everything. In addition to the grains, I had found other issues that I would have with some of the grains. Like I had a weevil infestation in my rice once because it wasn't, in a close enough container or something, or maybe it came with weevils when I bought it or whatever. But I had all my rice kind of in a mixed, big container like this, and it got weevils in it, and the weevils were just going through it. Now, it wasn't that big of a problem to solve because I looked up on the internet, something I miss, that weevils aren't poisonous or anything. So what I just did is I took the container, put it in my car in the middle of the summer, and just let it bake. And what I ended up with at the end was rice and some extra protein. So it worked out fine. But after that, what I would end up doing with rice is I wouldn't mix when I would get new, bulk bags of rice. I wouldn't mix them with the pre-existing rice in case they, might come with a, weevil or something like that. And I'd put it in much smaller containers. I would end up putting it into glass jars and things like that. So if one of them got, a weevil infestation, it was a lot less of a problem than if I'd had them all mixed together. So you'll learn a lot if you actually live this way and experiment with it. And also, I used to save a crap load of money because you could buy everything in bulk, and everything's always cheaper when you buy it in bulk, or almost always cheaper. Sometimes,
for some weird reason, buying in bulk, you know, you run into something and it actually costs more to buy more of it, you know, per unit. But you, generally speaking, buying in bulk saves you a lot of money. So I used to save a lot of money buying in bulk too. So good times. Yeah. But overall, yeah, I feel really good about the pantry, and largely because of all the experimentation I did over time, just figuring out what worked for me, what didn't work for me. Yeah. Feeling good about this one thing anyway.
The salsa's been cooking on the stove for about a half an hour, 30 minutes or so, and I timed that using my regular wind-up wristwatch. This one winds up by me moving my arm. But also in particular, I had the cuckoo clock on. The cuckoo reminded me that a half an hour had gone by. I probably could have gotten by with a little bit less time, but I always like to be a little on the safe side, give it a little extra time. You know, with these acidy foods, you can be a little bit more off the cuff with it, but I always like to be safe. So half hour, 30 minutes, they've been in there, and now I'm ready to take them out. What I'm going to use to pull them out is the same device I used to put them in there. So we'll just go in, and I'm looking at them, and the lids of each one are bulged out a little bit, and that's exactly the way that they should look. Right now, when you normally would buy these cans in the store, the lids are puckered down, but they've been boiling, so the pressure is built up on the inside. The lids are all bulging out. I'm going to put a little space between them as I'm setting them down. And as they cool, the air inside is going to become more dense, take up less space, and the pressure of our atmosphere is going to push down on those lids. Now, you know, with any jars, you want to be sure of this, but especially with these that are just kind of reused jars, you want to make sure that they get a nice seal and that the atmospheric pressure is holding the lid seal down solidly on these as a precaution. And here's the last one. All right, so what I got to do now is just allow these to cool off, and I just got to watch and make sure that every one of the seals puckers in. Now, the last thing I want to do, the last thing that one would want to do is to actually push them down, because that would simulate that they had had a seal without them necessarily actually having one. So you want to let them pucker down on their own. You don't want to be pushing the seals down. That's not going to seal them by pushing down. That's just going to be confusing as to whether or not they would have sealed on their own anyway. And it's very important that they seal. Holy shit, what is that?
What was that?
What is it?
Hold on. It says, be gone by sundown tomorrow, you'll both be dead. Take only one pack each. Oh, balls.
Please subscribe and tune in every Friday at 4:30 New York time for a new video. And if you'd like to support this channel, you can do so both through Patreon or PayPal.